Welcome friends for our Indian knowledge series video number 29, and today we will be discussing Indian 105, which talks about how to classify a non-current asset which is decided to be held for sale and not going to be used in generating cash flows by an entity, as well as what is the disclosure requirement in respect of a particular vertical of the business which is planned to be discontinued by an entity. Before we go into Ind AS 105, my repeated request is that any queries which you are having, any clarification you are seeking for, any inputs you wanted to give, please post in our YouTube channel itself so that it will be easier for me to respond in one single shot for all your queries, and it will reach immediately to all our subscribers without a requirement for relying on somebody else. Similarly, if any of your friends are getting the link from you and then watching this, you can urge them to be subscriber to our channel so that the moment I post any new standard, automatically they will get the intimation and they can follow us closely. With that, let us go into the standard proper. We have structured the discussion in our usual pattern. What is scoped out and what is scoped in this standard? What do you mean by non-current asset held for sale? What is the differentiation between a non-current asset and a non-current asset held for sale? What is the presentation requirement? What is the measurement requirement relating to non-current asset held for sale? We'll look into. The second area of discussion which we should look into in this is, in case a particular business vertical or an operating segment has been decided to be discontinued, how the related operations or the result of the related discontinued operation should be disclosed in the statement of profit and loss account. Because the user should be aware, whatever is included in the current year will not be available in the next year onwards because it is a discontinued operation. So that's the way in which the principle-based standards expects you to present in a meaningful manner the non-current assets which are held for sale and the result of the discontinued operations in the Ind AS financial statements. We will discuss that at length with a lot of case studies. There is a possibility that after it has been classified as non-current asset held for sale, or a particular operation has been decided to be discontinued, the decision of the management might have been changed because of new development. And in that case, what is non-current asset held for sale might have been now decided to be used in generating cash flows. In other words, it becomes a normal non-current asset. What is the accounting treatment in respect of that reclassification also, we will look into. Similarly, if a discontinued operation is now decided to be continued, how it should be presented in the current year financial statement as well as in the previous year financial statement, we will see in case of reclassification. And of course, what is the presentation requirement? What is the disclosure requirement in respect of both non-current asset held for sale and discontinued operations? We will look into that in detail. And lastly, AS 24, to some limited extent, is talking about discontinuing operation. The word itself is discontinuing operation, whereas Ind AS is talking about both non-current asset held for sale as well as discontinued operations. Okay, you'll see what is the differentiation or significant differences between Ind AS and AS for us to understand and master Ind AS 105 when we are putting that into practice. Right? With that, let us move on to the scope of this standard. When we are talking about the scope, as the name itself is suggesting, two aspects are covered. The first aspect is non-current asset which were previously used for generating cash flows now decided to be sold. So they have been held for sale. Maybe a particular asset or a group of asset, maybe a particular segment, whatever assets or liabilities which are relating to a particular segment itself is decided to be held for sale. You may recap, when we discussed Ind AS 1, we talked about one of the condition when an asset which is held for sale should be classified always as current asset. So what happens here? Previously it is a non-current asset which was shown under a non-current classification. Because it is now reclassified as held for sale, that goes into the second condition of current asset classification and meets the criteria that it's held for sale. Because it's held for sale, it has to be classified as current asset. Similarly, if one asset is classified as held for sale, it's fine. There could be a possibility that one complete group of asset, maybe a particular production line of a particular product or an operating segment, might have been decided to be disposed of. Maybe to have synergy to concentrate on core competence of the business rather than concentrating on every diluted verticals, it might be taking a decision. In that case, what happens is it is not single asset, right? It is group of asset. Those group of asset along with the related liability is called a disposal group. So either single asset or a disposal group, how to be measured, presented and disclosed is first part of Ind AS 105. What is the second part of Ind AS 105? Suppose an entity decided to dispose of a group and because of that it discontinues a particular business. Maybe the assets is not disposed of, but the business itself is discontinued. Both possibilities are there. Entire disposal group, because of that the operations are stopped for a particular segment, or maybe business is wiped off but the assets may be used for some other purposes. So in both the cases there is a decision which has been taken to discontinue particular operations of the entity. In that case, what will happen? The profit and loss account of the entity will consist of what is the revenue generated with respect to continuing operations and what has been discontinued or taken a decision to discontinue in the current year will also be there. If both are put together as part of a normal presentation, the user of the financial statement will not understand that a portion of that will not be available in the next year because it is discontinued. Accordingly, how to present and make disclosure relating to the results of a discontinued operations is the second part of Ind AS 105 scope. So one, non-current asset or disposal groups held for sale. Second is presentation and disclosure of results of discontinued operations. This is the two items which are in the scope. Basically, when we are talking about the scope, maybe we can understand in a simple principle that in the balance sheet, what was previously a non-current asset is now classified as non-current asset held for sale. So the presentation in the balance sheet changes in respect of non-current asset held for sale. And because it is non-current asset held for sale, the concept of depreciation, concept of amortization will no longer applicable. So in that case, how we have to measure, how we have to present, and what is the related disclosure is covered in the items relating to non-current asset held for sale, right? Now, What is the second portion? When we are having a result of a discontinued operation, is it having an effect on the balance sheet? Because only if the asset is classified as held for sale, we reclassify the balance sheet. But in case if it is a result of a discontinued operation, it actually affects the statement of profit and loss. Because it affects the statement of profit and loss, we are trying to show how the results of a discontinued operations are to be presented as per Ind AS 105, and what is the related disclosures required for the user to understand this particular concept. This is the two things which are in scope. What is not in scope is very simple. Whatever is already covered by another standard is not part of this particular standard. This is the way in which we have learned, right? In all other standards also, we have learned the similar way. So the same logic applicable here also. If it is covered by another standard, there is a specific requirement of accounting, measurement, and disclosure requirement. So we will go with that particular disclosure requirement with respect to those items, right? For example, deferred tax asset as per Ind AS 12 has to be accounted for, not as per Ind AS 105. Financial asset which are covered under Ind AS 109 is covered under 109. So only non-current asset which is classified will get covered here. Employee benefit assets, the plan assets and related assets relating to employee benefits as per Ind AS 19, that has to be considered as per Ind AS 19 and not as per this. Biological assets which are covered under Ind AS 41, we have already discussed this also, right? Biological assets which are measured at fair value less cost to sell. If you are not clear about what is biological asset, please go back and revisit or view our video on Ind AS 41. You will have a better guidance on that. Suppose if something is covered by means of insurance contract as per Ind AS 104, which we will cover a little later, and that is also covered as part of this. Interestingly, IFRS 5 also says that in case if there are some investment properties which are fair valued and the fair value changes are accounted as part of Ind AS 40, IAS 40. It says that is also excluded from the scope of IFRS 5. But since we have decided in Ind AS 40 not to have the option of fair valuation model, that particular paragraph is not there in Ind AS 105. To that extent, IFRS 5 and Ind AS 105 is also having a change. That is mainly because Ind AS 40 is having only one option, allowing the cost model for investment property. Whereas when we are coming to the case of accounting for investment property under IAS 40, you have two options, either to account as per cost model or as per fair value model. That's the reason why IFRS 5 deals with that particular investment property as well as an exclusion. Okay, here that is not required because we have not excluded that particular item in this. So these are all the items which are outside the scope of this standard. Wherever you have any doubt, please go back to our videos on the respective standards and you can have a better clarity on what we are discussing about. 109 we have not yet covered. We will cover that in a very detailed manner, because my understanding is more than 20 to 30% of marks are coming from Ind AS 109 one way or other. So accordingly, we will cover that in detail in a later video. Now, we have seen what is scoped in and what is scoped out. Let us try to understand the first part of Ind AS 105. The first part talks about non-current asset held for sale or disposal groups which are held for sale, right? And we said that it affects the financial statement presentation, especially the balance sheet, and accordingly how the remeasurement happens, that also have an impact on the P&L account. Per se, the format of the financial P&L account is not affected by non-current asset held for sale or disposal group. So that is only coming as part of the discontinued operations, right? That's what we are very clear on. This has an effect on the balance sheet, and because of the remeasurement, it will have a consequential effect in case the asset goes down or asset goes up in the statement of profit and loss. Okay, you should have that core principle very, very clear in your mind. When we are taking non-current asset, it may be one single asset, as I have already discussed, or it may be a disposal group. Okay, when we are talking about disposal group, let me ask a single question for you to understand. We said certain items of the assets will not be part of this particular standard. We talked about Ind AS 12, we talked about financial asset, we talked about employee benefit asset, we talked about insurance contract assets. All those items, when we are actually saying that outside the purview, what could be expected to be covered here? That too non-current asset or disposal group. Normally, property, plant and equipment, intangible assets are the items which will be covered as part of the non-current assets held for sale. All other items will be covered by the respective standard. Inventory is covered by a respective standard, right? Like that it goes. And what is left out will be normally the profit and property, plant, equipment, intangible assets, maybe intangible assets under development, and whatever goodwill which is associated to that particular disposal group, right? That's the way in which we have to look into. Now, what is non-current asset held for sale or a disposal group? To qualify that, what is expected is they are planned to be disposed of as a group in a single transaction. That means it is not just I'm going to dispose it of. No, you have already taken a decision, informed a decision, formal plan to dispose it of in a single transaction. That is what has to be considered as non-current asset held for sale. The management says we are having an idea of disposing certain items maybe after a point of time. Those are not, unless they are covered to be disposed of in a single transaction and an actual decision has been taken by the management on that particular aspect. When an asset is being sold individually, Ind AS 105 will apply only if it is a non-current asset. Very interesting point. When we are talking about a disposal group, there could be a possibility of non-current asset, current assets all put together, including a non-current liability or current liability relating to that particular segment or particular disposal group. Whereas if you are talking about an individual asset, Ind AS 105 will apply only to that non-current asset and not to any other current asset. You have to be very, very clear on this core principle as well. Only for disposal group, we'll take other than non-current asset also as part of the disposal group. When a group of assets are planned to be disposed of, Ind AS 105 will apply for the entire disposal group as a whole. So you will not say that, sir, for current asset I will use something and non-current asset I will use something. The entire disposal group will get covered as per Ind AS 105. So you have to be careful on, is it a single asset or it is the entire disposal group. In a disposal group, other than non-current asset could also be part of our Ind AS 105. Okay, what is the criteria for classifying an item as held for sale? There should be some reasons or conditions which should be applied. So what the standard is actually talking about and how to classify certain items as held for sale? It says a non-current asset or a disposal group will meet the criteria of classified as held for sale only if it is available for immediate sale in the present condition. 2 points: immediate sale, available for immediate sale. Second is in the present condition. You should not repair it and then make it as available for sale. So it is readily available for immediate sale. Then it is a non-current asset held for sale. It is not simply saying this. It also attaches one more condition as a cumulative condition. Please see, here it says and. Whereas when we are talking about non-current asset held for sale, we said non-current asset held for sale or disposal group, where we have said either one is covered. Whereas to qualify as a non-current asset classification, the asset or the disposal group should be immediately available for sale in the present condition, and the sale is highly probable. It is not saying probable, highly probable. That means certain that you will make the sale. Okay, we have to understand what you mean by available for immediate sale and sale is highly probable. Both we have to see, right? Both the criteria should be met. That's what we have said. What is when it is considered as highly probable sale? What are all the indications? What are all the conditions which we are looking for to ensure that a particular item is considered as highly probable sale transaction? One, the appropriate level of management who are having the competency to take a decision have committed a plan to sell an asset or a disposal group. That's what I have said. There is a former plan to sell. They have committed to a plan to sell an asset or a disposal group with a competent level of authority. Normally, a board of directors will take the decision in case of a Ind AS company. Second, there is an active program to trace the potential buyer and to complete the selling plan which might have been initiated. For example, when I have decided to sell an asset or a disposal group, it is not stops at that level. Whether I have taken active steps to ensure that the sale will be happening. For example, I appoint an agent to identify the potential buyer and I have initiated the plans for the sale of the non-current asset. That should also be demonstrated. Thirdly, the asset or disposal group must be marketed for sale at a price that is reasonable in relation to the current fair value. Interesting point. You will understand that in another slide. What it says that when I am classifying an asset as non-current asset held for sale, it is expected that it is saleable at the current fair value of the asset. Suppose if that item will be disposed of at a level lower than the current fair value. For example, if it will be sold only as a scrap, whether it is a disposal group or a non-current asset held for sale, the standard says no. You have already used it for the entire economic useful life. Now it is going to be scrapped. So accordingly, it is not current fair value. So it is not an item which is considered as highly probable sale. Similarly, another example which I can talk about is that I have decided to abandon a particular non-current asset, maybe a machinery from active use, because it is the product which will be manufactured by that is does not have any market. In that case, I have decided to abandon that. It can be only sold at a scrap and not based on any current fair value. In that case, that particular asset cannot be marketed at a price which is at the current fair value. So it is not considered as a highly probable sale, and that particular asset will not qualify as a non-current asset held for sale. It's an abandoned asset. When I'm using the word abandoned asset, it can be disposed of only as a scrap, but it is having more than the carrying amount in the books. There is another standard which has to come to our mind. What is that another standard? Yes, impairment test to be done in that particular situation. That's what the standard says. You have to move out. Even if you wanted to classify a particular item, one of the stage which we will consider is that once a decision taken, you have to first take impairment test and then you have to go to the next step. That's the way in which the standard was working out. So the third condition is it should be capable of being sold at its current fair value, not at scrap value. Fourth condition is very interesting. If it is highly probable sale, then it is expected to be completed within 1 year from the date of classification. I decided to classify an asset as non-current asset, but I am not able to identify a customer or buyer for 3 or 4 years. It is not a non-current asset held for sale because the sale is not highly probable. Both conditions should be satisfied. Sale should be highly probable. If it has to be highly probable, it says that from the date where you have classified, again, please understand, I am using the word from the date of classification as non-current asset held for sale. Within 12 months, the sale is expected to be completed. Not from the end of the financial year in which it is reclassified. From the date of taking a decision to reclassify, it should be sold within 12 months. Right? Whether the 12 months is a fixed rule. In that case, what happens is our Ind AS is based, considered as a, what we call it as a rule-based accounting standard. But we always claim that it's a principle-based accounting standard, right? So there are some exceptions based on the facts and circumstances of the case where it can be even considered more than 1 year. We will see that. Okay, there are some stringent conditions which has to be met. And finally, significant changes to or withdrawal from the plan to sell the asset is unlikely. Meaning what? I have management has taken a decision to sell a plant, taken a decision to sell a plant or a disposal group, and it has actively taken the program for initiating the plan for sale, and it is also going to be sold at the current fair value. That is also expected to be, and sale will also be completed within 12 months from the date of classification as held for sale. But the management decided that I may withdraw or I am looking for alternatives. So in that case, there is a possibility of withdrawing from the plan. If it is unlikely that the management will not withdraw that plan, that is an indication that there will be a highly probable sale. All these five conditions, it is not actually mentioned as a condition in the standard, but when defining highly probable sale, it says, it uses the word, the appropriate level of management must be committed to sell the plant and active program, and it can be marketed at current fair value and sale consideration. That means indirectly the standard expects that all these conditions should be satisfied to make the sale or expected sale as a highly probable sale. If it is not a highly probable sale, then to that extent, that sale should not be considered, that asset or disposal group shall not be considered as meeting the criteria of Ind AS 105. That is the reason why we are discussing about highly probable sale. Now, let's take some examples for us to understand this concept. A buyer is identified for the textile division of ABC Limited and the price is also agreed. However, based on the current year performance of the textile division, ABC Limited suspect that final agreed price will be significantly below the price at which it is willing to sell. That is, the amount at which the expected sale will happen will be much lower than its current fair value. That is one thing which they are expecting. Because of that, ABC Limited begin to consider alternatives to selling the textile division. Is the textile division can be classified as held for sale or disposal group? Let us put that into the five conditions which we have seen for a highly probable sale. First of all, there should be a committed plan. Yes, they have taken a committed plan, right? Second is, have they taken the plan for disposing of the, or there is a process which has been initiated, that is also seems to be initiated, right? But the third condition where they are saying the asset or the disposal group is expected to be disposed at the current fair value. Here they have a doubt whether it can be sold at the current fair value. They believe that it will be sold much lower than the current fair value. So that the third condition seems to be little difficult. And the fourth condition says that the sale, to be highly probable, it should be expected to be completed within 12 months from the date on which it has been classified as held for sale. Here there is no indication or information about that particular date. So we will assume that the condition has been satisfied. The last condition says that there is no plans to withdraw from the planned sale. It is not unlikely that the management will withdraw or the entity will withdraw from the plan. But here it says they are looking for alternatives, right? So two issues which is coming in here out of the five conditions. One is it is looking for alternatives. So there is a likelihood of they withdraw from the plan. So the fifth condition is not satisfied. The third condition which says that the asset should be disposed of equivalent to the price at which it will be able to realize the current fair value. That is also seems to be doubtful. In both the scenarios, out of five conditions, three conditions only satisfied. Accordingly, this is not considered to be a held for sale disposal group. And accordingly, Ind AS 105 should not be applied. You will continue to apply the existing accounting standards based on which the various assets relating to that disposal group of textile division should be accounted for. You should not change any of the accounting principle. Now, let's go into another example. Here we are saying Spinoff Limited decided to dispose its bottle making unit. So bottling unit is decided to be disposed of. And the decision has been taken by the board. That's a competent authority has taken a formal plan to dispose it of on 1st October 2019. However, management believes that identifying the potential buyer and completing the transaction may happen in June 2021. Whether the bottling unit is a disposable group, what we have said, one of the condition is to be highly probable sale. The sale is expected to be complete within 1 year from the date of classification as held for sale. So 1 year from the date of classification, that is 1st October 2019, to 1 year should be 30th September 2020, whereas they expect identifying the potential buyer and completing the sale itself will take June 2021. It is not highly probable sale, right? Because it is not highly probable sale, it is not meeting the second condition of held for sale criteria. So accordingly, bottling plant or bottling unit is not held for sale. So the sale is not expected to happen within 1 year of from the date of classification. As I have said, if you are always considering a particular timeline as your condition, what happens is that becomes a rule-based standard. There could be certain situations where certain facts are prohibiting the sale to be made within 12 months as anticipated. So in that case, they are saying 1 year deadline can be extended if the delay is caused by events and circumstances beyond the entity's control. Let me touch this point with the current example. Assuming that the originally estimated period of 1 year within which the sale will be completed is, say, for example, mid of March. But the COVID pandemic has made the lockdown and industries have been closed. Economic slowdown has happened. Because of that, the entity has to postpone the sale by, assuming that the government is also giving a lot of timeline, no? Postponement of due dates and timeline. Similarly, in the contract also, they will use a force majeure clause, and using that, they say that you please allow me to complete the sale in another 6 months' time. So in that case, which is beyond the control of the entity, can be an example which we can consider. So it is not intentional to postpone the sale by circumstances made me to do that. It is beyond the control. Sufficient evidence also should be existent. So simply by saying that it is beyond my control is not enough, and you are still remaining committed to continue and dispose the sale, dispose that particular asset. So completion of the plan is still there, committed to the plan is still there, but only thing is there is a delay. In that particular situation, the 1 year deadline can be extended is what Ind AS 105 gives as a judgmental area. So you can make your judgment based on the facts of the case. Now let us understand this particular position also with some example. An entity is committed to its selling plan of a manufacturing facility in its present condition and hence classified that as held for sale. It's a disposal group which has been classified as held for sale. After a firm purchase commitment, the buyer's inspection identifies environmental damages not previously known to exist. So what has happened was there was a committed purchase plan also. Buyer has also identified. But when the buyer is making an inspection, there is some environmental damages which was originally existing. The entity is required by the buyer to make good the damage, which will extend the time frame of 1 year to complete the sale within 1 year. Can we say that extended period to complete that to ensure that the damages have been made good can also be added to the part, because we are saying that the entity is committed to the sale and it is beyond the entity's control. So where we have said that if the entity has initiated the actions to make good the damages and satisfactory rectification is highly probable, suppose if it is possible to correct it, then it is okay. If it is not at all possible to correct it, at no point of time the buyer will be buying it, so it's not highly probable. So you have to consider the complete fact pattern on the basis of which you still believe that the sale can be completed and the seller has committed to dispose of the unit and they are making the process to ensure that the sale will get completed. The process is nothing but they are making good the damage, environmental damage. In that case, the exception given in this standard for the 1 year limit can be considered in this. Let's try to understand. I have made a passing comment. In case if the asset is going to fetch the fair value, current fair value, it is normally considered as part of the disposal group or non-current asset held for sale if it is an individual asset. Suppose if the asset is abandoned, whether that abandoned non-current asset is within the scope of this, one of the problem is it will not be sold at the current fair value. It is normally will be disposed of at a scrap value and no cash flows are being used. It is only abandoned from active use but not held for sale, right? So in that case, whether it will get covered, which is abandoned or planned to be abandoned from active use are not held for sale. These are non-current asset retired from active use and not planned to be disposed of. They will continue to be shown as part of non-current asset classification only. But at the same time, what will happen? Because you are abandoning a particular asset, the pattern of use is changing. When the pattern of use is changing, it is one of the internal indicators of impairment. So you should consider whether impairment testing to be done as per Ind AS 36. That is the second part of the story. Whenever I'm talking about, you may be wondering, when I'm talking about the concept of the particular standard, if the concept is not applicable, I'm recalling the concept of another standard. Why? This connected reading will always help you to remember the concept very, very strongly. Holistic approach is what I use. The holistic approach of application of a particular standard with respect to recognition, measurement, presentation, disclosure is what is the principle of Ind AS. When you apply that, you will never make any error. That is the reason why I am trying to say that when the non-current asset is abandoned or retired from active use, the idea is it may be brought back to active use and the carrying amount will be recovered through continuing use. At the same time, it's a trigger of an impairment indicator. That's what you are supposed to consider further. For example, there is a mine which has been fully exhausted, exploited, and it is abandoned. The mine is abandoned because there may not be any value for it, assuming that it's a leased mine. After the lease, it has to be given back. So in that case, the mine is abandoned, even though the mine is a non-current asset. Whether I have to consider that as part of held for sale? No, it's only abandoned. Suppose subsequently they believe that some more reserves are there, they will start exploiting that reserve also. In that case, it is still available for use in generating cash flows in continuous use. Which are abandoned are going to be used till their economic useful life, are going to be scrapped or closed rather than sold. So in simple terms, it is what is having an economic useful life, but you have decided that cash flows will not get generated. Or maybe you have decided that the active useful life is already over. You are going to scrap it. In that case, it is abandoned asset. Which is abandoned asset is outside the purview of Ind AS 105. Similarly, a non-current asset which is temporarily taken out of use is not considered to be abandoned. For example, I am manufacturing a particular type of car for which I have made a lot of molds, right? But there is a sudden spike in another model. So for the time being, I am just shelving the model which is not picking up quickly, but I am concentrating on the high sale, higher volume sale model, and I am producing that. But there is no impairment which is happening for the other production line where the other car or other components can be manufactured. So in that case, it is also not considered an asset which is abandoned. It is actually temporarily taken out of use. So it will be brought back for the use. In that case, it continue to be as part of your property, plant and equipment, right? And not as part of your Ind AS 105. Let us take some example to understand, because examples are like stories which will make you to always have a very strong understanding of the particular situation. Entity ceases to use a manufacturing plant because demand has declined. However, the plant is maintained in a workable condition and is expected to be brought back into use in future when demand picks up. So what is happening? Temporarily, it is out of your use. So in that case, it is not an abandoned asset. It is also not held for sale. It should continue to be used or classified as non-current asset only. It will not be reclassified as per 105, and it will not be tested for impairment. And maybe you can say impairment testing, it may be an indication and you can test it. But the way in which the fact has mentioned, the demand for the particular plant has declined, but they are expecting that the demand will be picking up. So indications of impairment exist, but when we work it out, your recoverable amount may be higher than your carrying amount. So impairment loss may not arise. So that could be a possible scenario. Okay, now we have understood what is the held for sale or disposal group, and what is the two conditions which are supposed to be met. And when we are talking about the highly probable, what are all the five conditions which has to be considered, and whether non-current asset held for sale will also include abandoned asset or the assets which are going to be scrapped or they are retired from active use for a temporary period. We have said it should not be included as part of it. So we identified what is a non-current asset held for sale or what is the disposal group which is covered as per Ind AS 105. So recognition principle has been considered, but we have to measure, we have to put a value, how it has to be measured. Interestingly, the initial measurement goes on a stage by stage conditions to be checked. Or maybe I have to say there are some processes which you have to apply when you are initially measuring a particular item which is reclassified as held for sale. The first point which it says is that the moment you are planning to sell or decision taken to sell a particular item of non-current asset. The first worry is whether it will be capable of being sold at the carrying amount or there will be a loss. And accordingly, the decision to sell an asset as an internal indication that the pattern of use of an asset changes. The moment it changes, you go back to Ind AS 36 first to test it for impairment. If there is an impairment loss, reduce that impairment loss from the carrying amount of the item which is planned to be reclassified as held for sale. First impairment has to be tested and adjusted. Just before you are reclassifying in the financial statement, first you have taken a decision. The moment you have taken a decision, you are testing for impairment, adjust that and bring in the carrying amount of that particular asset to its recoverable amount. Just before the held for sale classification is being made, it says you have to measure all the assets in accordance with the respective accounting standard. For example, if I am saying it is a specific standard, it's a property, plant and equipment, I will measure that as per Ind AS 16. That means if there is a depreciation which has to be applied up to that particular date, I will apply the depreciation. If it has to be tested for impairment further, I will test that as impairment as per Ind AS 16. Similarly, if it is Ind AS 38 to be applied because it's an intangible assets, I will apply the amortization principles. And in case if it is an investment property, I will apply the principles of investment property standard Ind AS 40 for that particular purpose. If it is a particular asset, suppose if it is a disposal group, what will happen? Yes, you are in the right path. Not only the particular asset, but the entire assets in the disposal group along with its liabilities. Right? You recollect in Ind AS 1, we have told that in the decision tree for current liabilities, we said current liability which is held for sale. At the time, we have also asked a question, how a liability is held for sale? The liability is held for sale means it is forming part of a disposal group which comes under Ind AS 105. So if it is a disposal group, you have to measure all the assets in the disposal group, all the liabilities in the disposal group, and then as per the applicable accounting standards. You have done that, you have measured it. It is not saying stop at that level. Update the impairment assessment. Decision taken to sell, first you have applied impairment standards straight away and adjusted the impairment loss. After the applicable accounting standards have been applied for the disposal group, again update your impairment testing. And once that impairment has been adjusted, the balance is considered as the carrying amount as per Ind AS 105 on initial measurement. The moment you have decided what is the carrying amount as per Ind AS 105, you have to stop amortization in case if it is an intangible assets expected to classified as held for sale, or stop depreciation if it is property, plant, equipment which is held for sale. You are clear on this aspect, right? Decision to sell, first impairment test. Just before the reclassification, you are going to remeasure all the assets and liabilities in the group as per the respective standards. Again, update your impairment, arrive at your carrying amount. After the carrying amount has been arrived at, stop amortization or depreciation, depending upon whether it's intangible assets or it is property, plant, equipment. You may ask the question, if it is a disposal group, where is the question of I am stopping amortization and depreciation? You will stop amortization or depreciation with respect to the particular non-current asset which are included in the particular disposal group. So, for example, property, plant, equipment of a particular segment, you will stop depreciation. Intangible assets relating to the particular segment which is part of the disposal group, you will start amortization. Okay. Thus, this is the second stage with respect to the initial measurement. We have now arrived at what is the carrying amount. The third step are the portion on the date of classifying as held for sale. When you are passing the entry in the books of accounts, it says it has always to be presented at the carrying amount decided just before the held for sale classification. and the fair value less cost to sell. The fair value less cost to sell, we have already considered this as part of Ind AS 38 impairment of assets. So similar concept, fair value less cost to sell, you have to see what is the lower of the amount, carrying amount or fair value less cost to sell. Suppose the carrying amount is 100 and the fair value less cost of disposal on the date of classification is 80, you have to write down the non-current asset held for sale to 80 and 20 rupees should be charged to the P&L account on the date, not as an impairment but as an adjustment of your non-current asset held for sale, because in this case we have already taken a decision that is a asset held for sale. On that basis we are reclassifying, we have arrived at what is the carrying amount also in the second stage itself. So accordingly here it is not an impairment test, it is accounting as per Ind AS 105. This lower of carrying amount less fair value less cost of sale looks familiar for you when you wanted to apply another standard. Yes, exactly. It is Ind AS 2 where inventories are measured at lower of the cost, and in this case cost is replaced by carrying amount. Cost and net realizable value. What is net realizable value? The price which you are expecting to realize for the asset minus the cost of sale, right? So it is a similarity to Ind AS 2 inventories, but the concepts which is used there is cost and net realizable value. Here it is carrying amount and fair value less cost to sell, because fair value less cost to sell may be different from net realizable value. Okay, so this again you can bring it to your normal conditions. And what happens, suppose if the carrying amount is lower but the fair value less cost to sell is higher, will I take that amount as part of my P&L account? Normally no, but in case if you have tested for impairment, what we have said, impairment loss can be reversed to that extent what you have already considered. And if it is a depreciable asset, what we have said, the related depreciation should also be adjusted and you have to arrive at the derived carrying amount. That's what we have discussed in Ind AS 16 property plant equipment. We have also discussed that in Ind AS 38 intangible asset, and we have also discussed that extensively in Ind AS 36, right? If it is a reversal of an impairment loss, then apply the principles which we have discussed in Ind AS 36 impairment of assets. Okay, so to that extent it is an impairment loss which is debited to the P&L account, you reverse it in the P&L account, right? Otherwise you will not realize it. Okay, now what happens to the loss? Loss goes to the accounting. When the loss goes to the accounting treatment comes back to you in a similar understanding which we had earlier. Yes, when we are talking about how the impairment loss has to be accounted for in Ind AS 36, we said the impairment loss of a CGU has to be first applied in respect of the goodwill allocated to that particular CGU. Instead of the CGU, here disposal group itself is a CGU or a segment. So what is the goodwill which is allocated to that? That should be first knocked off against the loss. Then if there is any balance, that balance should be allocated pro rata to the carrying value of the asset, non-current asset in that particular disposal group. So what will happen? First impairment adjusted in the goodwill. Sorry, the loss is adjusted in the goodwill. Assuming that the loss is 100 and the goodwill which was allocated in this particular CGU is 75. You adjust 75 and make goodwill nil with a corresponding debit to your P&L account, right? Another 25, reduce pro rata to all non-current assets in the group. Credit is given to the non-current assets in the group on a pro rata basis, debit go to the P&L account. Normally this allocation pro rata basis is nothing but property, plant, equipment and intangible asset, because I have said majority of the items are not falling as non-current asset held for sale. When you are having a disposal group, whether I have to adjust against other items. For example, there is a portion of advances, deposits, or maybe a portion of inventory is also there, which is part of the disposal group, which has a shelf life. Whether I have to adjust this loss against that particular item also and brought down? No, for a simple reason. This has to be brought down from the value of the non-current asset in the group and not on current asset. So you will normally adjust only on PPE and intangible assets. Now, this is the initial measurement. Let us take some example. A Limited acquired a property for 2 lakh. After a few years of cumulative depreciation, is 80,000 has been recognized. Subsequently, the property is classified as held for sale as per Ind AS 105. So here, original cost is there, accumulated depreciation is there. So carrying amount is nothing but 2 lakh minus 80, it's 1,20,000. Okay. At the time of classification as held for sale, it will be measured at lower of its carrying amount, which is 1,20,000. And it has its fair value less cost of sale is 1 lakh rupees. So what is the accounting treatment? So carrying amount is 1,20,000 and your fair value less cost to sell is 1 lakh rupee. What is the amount at, what is the accounting treatment for this? The first thing which you are supposed to see is that because it does not show any indication of impairment, we assume that the impairment test has been already performed and no impairment loss is to be recognized on the date where they have taken a decision to sell, as well as at the time of classifying that as held for sale. In both the scenarios, impairment has already been tested and it is adjusted. So we assume that no impairment loss is required. But the fair value less cost to sell is estimated at 1 lakh rupees at the date of reclassification. So on the date of reclassification, when the fair value less cost to sell is lower, we said it's not impairment loss, right? And accordingly, lower of carrying amount and fair value less cost to sell should be accounted for. In this case, fair value less cost to sell is 1 lakh rupees. That should be recognized as part of your loss. How this will be, journal entry will be passed. Debit profit and loss account with 20,000 rupees for write down of non-current asset held for sale. Credit the non-current asset held for sale, the property value. So it comes down to the disposal value, that is 1 lakh rupees. Okay, it's an individual asset. What two things which is not included? Impairment testing is not there because we assume that not there. And another thing is, it is not one single asset. It's one single asset and not group of assets. So we have just talked about straight away adjusting, no goodwill, all other things has been considered. What is the subsequent measurement which we have to do? Subsequent measurement, we said depreciation should be stopped, amortization should be stopped. And accordingly, always it should be presented at lower of its carrying amount as per Ind AS 105 and its fair value less cost to sell on the remeasurement date, provided it still meets the recognition criteria as held for sale. Highly probable sale, which we have said, right? So always you have to be careful. When you are saying highly probable sale, subsequent measurement happens in the second year. That means it's not highly probable sale. It is not meeting the recognition criteria of held for sale at all as per Ind AS 105. That's the reason why it says first condition you have to satisfy is whether the asset or the disposal group still meets the held for sale classification. If so, again assess what is the carrying amount under respective standard. Okay. And what is the fair value less cost to sell for that particular standard? Only thing is, you should not apply depreciation and amortization. With that, check. In case if there is further losses, that's a fair value less cost to sell is still lower than the carrying amount, that further losses again to be adjusted against the goodwill relating to that disposal group or balance goodwill after the initial adjustment, whatever is there, that should be first adjusted. If the goodwill is fully amortized, then it will be allocated to other non-current asset, that is property, plant, equipment or intangible assets on a pro rata basis. Suppose if there is a gain, subsequently when I am measuring, the fair value less cost to sell has exceeded the carrying amount. What I have said, that excess in the carrying amount, if it is relating to previously recognized impairment loss, you have to brought it back. Assuming that when I have tested, there is no impairment loss, but the carrying amount was lower than, the carrying amount is higher than the fair value less cost to sell. I have returned down the carrying amount to its fair value less cost to sell as per Ind AS 105, not as an impairment, but as per Ind AS 105, write down has happened. Then no reversal will happen even if there is a gain in the subsequent period. So write down will only happen. It is exactly like what we have seen in case of inventory. Inventory will always be measured at lower of cost and net realizable value. Only thing is, when the net realizable value changes, we said whatever we have already written off can also be written back. But here it says gain will be limited to previous impairment loss and not what you have written down from the carrying amount. So that cannot be reversed. Suppose if the disposal group has a negative fair value, that means you don't have a selling price, but you have to incur cost for disposal of that. So in that case, it says that you cannot write down below zero. You have to stop at your carrying amount. No provision has to be made, because it feels that the cost of disposal is nothing but a future loss. It will be an expenditure only in the year in which you have actually disposing of the particular asset, and to that extent you have to recognize only in that particular year and don't create any provision. That's what the standard actually suggests us to do. Okay, now we have seen the recognition principle, we have seen also the measurement principle. Initial measurement we have seen, subsequent measurement we have seen. Now how to present the non-current asset or disposal group classified as held for sale? It says it should be classified as held for sale and should be shown separately from other assets in the balance sheet. On the face of the balance sheet, non-current asset held for sale will be a separate line item. Because it's held for sale, it will be shown under current asset classification, but it should not be part of, for example, it includes some inventory, some debtors, some cash balances. You cannot go on including that in the respective line items. It has to be shown as a total item as held for sale in that particular separate line item on the balance sheet under current assets. So that's what you are supposed to see as far as the presentation of non-current asset held for sale or the disposal group held for sale, right? Similarly, the liabilities which are relating to the disposal group should be grouped and shown as liabilities relating to disposal group classified as held for sale as a separate item other than the liabilities. That is what you are supposed to do on the presentation of non-current asset held for or the disposal group which is held for sale. Because the asset has to be shown as a separate line item and the liability has to be shown separately in the line item, what does it mean? You cannot offset and show as a single item in the balance sheet. Assets and liabilities should not be offset and presented as a single item on the face of the balance sheet. Suppose if you are having any income or expenditure which is directly recognized in the equity relating to the held for sale assets, for example a revaluation model related non-current asset which was directly related in equity as a revaluation reserve, that should also be separately disclosed. It should not be kept as part of the normal item which is relating to held for sale. That should be there. Suppose if you are acquiring a subsidiary with a clear intention to dispose of the subsidiary, it is acquired for held for sale. In that case, you have to disclose the major clauses of assets and liabilities is not required to be done. The entire investment made in the subsidiary itself will be shown as classified or as held for sale. Any gain on or loss on the remeasurement which is not meeting the definition of a discontinued operation shall be included in the P&L from continuing operation. Interesting point. What we normally say, a disposal group can be a discontinued operation, and not all discontinuing operations are disposal group. So that means I might have planned to held it for sale, but not abandoned the entire operations of a particular segment. It may be only a group of asset. In that case, if it is not meeting the criteria of a discontinued operation, then you have to recognize this loss or gain as a separate line item in the P&L account and not in the P&L account as part of your continuing operation and not in arriving at your net result on discontinuing operation. Very, very interesting point which we are supposed to have. Another interesting point, very, very important point. Current year, I have reclassified certain non-current asset as held for sale or kept certain items at disposal groups, kept certain liabilities as disposal group. Because of that, that comes as a current classification. But previous year, it was a non-current. At the time, I never took any decision for disposal. What I am supposed to do with respect to that particular item, whether current year number should also be reclassified, previous year item should also be reclassified? No. Previous year, it still meets the criteria of non-current asset held for sale or the any other liability which may be non-current liability. But only in the current year, the decision is taken for reclassification, and to that extent, it should not be represented in the comparative period. That means only current period, it will be shown as current non-current asset held for sale or disposal groups. But in the previous year, it will continue to be shown in the respective categories of asset. Maybe non-current asset with respect to property, plant, equipment and intangible assets, inventories in respect of current asset, like that it will never be restated, because in the last year, based on the facts and circumstances, current and non-current classification has been changed. Subsequently, if I am changing it, it never changes the position as of the previous year. So do not represent the comparatives when you took a decision to classify a non-current asset or a disposal group for sale, held for sale. Okay, interesting and important point. Now, what are all the disclosure which is required in respect of non-current asset held for sale or disposal group which has been held for sale? What is the description of the non-current asset or the disposal group? What is the facts and circumstances of the sale leading to the expected disposal, and what is the time frame which has been decided for expected sale? That will also be looked into. Gain or loss which has been recognized in the P&L account, and what is the caption in which it has been recognized, has to be looked into. Suppose if it is relating to a particular segment, the disposal group is relating to a particular segment, your disclosure as per Ind AS 108 should also specifically talk about to which reportable segment it is actually considered. That should also be disclosed. Suppose if you are changing a plant from disposal to continuous use, you have to disclose about the facts and circumstances leading to the decision and what is the related effect given in the balance sheet and profit and loss account. We will see that it's part of the reclassification. The accounting treatment comes as part of reclassification. Maybe we will discuss that. So the effect which we are going to discuss subsequently should also be explained here. If you are changing your plan to sale, okay, or discontinuing an operation, in both the scenarios there will be a reclassification. We will see that. So this is a disclosure required for held for sale asset. Now, first part of Ind AS 105 has been fully covered. Now we are coming to the second part of Ind AS 105, which is how a discontinuing operation should be presented as part of the statement of profit and loss account, and what are all the disclosures required, and how the comparatives of the previous year should be dealt with. This is coming as part of the second portion of the Ind AS 105. Discontinuing operation is a component of the entity, okay, which is disposed during the reporting period, or it is classified as held for sale as part of the disposal group. So even if you have decided to, you have discontinued or disposed during the year, you have to consider this discontinue operation. Whereas you are planning to dispose the entire disposal group, that is also covered here. One is past tense, another is future tense. Whereas if you see disposal group under the first part of Ind AS 105, we are talking about only the future event, not what is disposed during the current period we are not considering, because it's a non-current asset which is already disposed. What is held for sale is what is coming in. The second part is arising out of Ind AS 105, non-current asset which is part of the disposal group, the disposal group which are held for sale, that will also be triggering a discontinued operation. In simple terms, we are talking about a discontinued operation as well as discontinuing operation as part of Ind AS 105. Okay, but what we are considering as per Ind AS 24 is discontinuing operation is what we are talking about. So what has already happened is not part of Ind AS 24. That's the only difference which we are considering. And we should also look for certain other conditions. We will see that condition separately for you to understand that. So one thing, it may be what is disposed during the year, what is proposed to be disposed as held for sale or disposal group. And that another condition should also be fulfilled. We will look into that condition separately. I am just trying to put you the concept of when it meets the criteria of a discontinuing operation by putting it in a decision tree. Again, this decision tree is not part of your standard. Whatever conditions which has been given in the standard, I am putting that into your decision tree for the purposes of easy understanding. If at any time you have a doubt, come back to this particular portion of our video, revisit, try to understand each and every flow based on which you take your call with the fact patterns which has been given in your question. The first question which we are talking about, do the operations being discontinued is a single cash generating unit or collection of a cash generating unit? Okay, so the operation should be relating to a cash generating unit or collection of cash generating unit. That means it is capable of generating cash flows independent of other assets. That's what we have said, cash generating unit. So operation should be able to generate cash generating unit. If you are not able to identify what is independent cash flows which is generating and independent outflows relating to the cash generating unit, how you can be able to arrive at the result of that? That is the reason why it is asking for, do the operation being discontinued is a single cash generating unit or 2-3 cash generating unit put together you are planning to discontinue. If I am saying no, there is no question of discontinued operation. For example, if I am saying it is not relating to a CGU, it is only a particular asset or group of asset, but that group of asset is not meeting the recognition criteria of a CGU. CGU, we have said that it is defined as per Ind AS 36, impairment of asset. Same definition is applicable here also. Okay. So if it is not a single CGU or collection of CGU, then it is not meeting the discontinued operation classification. So any revenue generated or expenses met should be part of your continuing operation. That's the reason why if you are talking about a particular asset which is temporarily discontinued and you are going to use it again, it is not actually meeting that particular criteria. So it is a continuing operation. Now, suppose if I am saying yes, it's a single CGU or collection of CGU, the next question which we are saying that is the component a separate major line of the business or geographical area of operation. Okay, it's a single CGU, but it's not a major line of business or it is not major line of a geographical area of operation. It is a small item. Then it says, if I'm saying yes, it's a major component, then I'm saying whether the component has been already disposed of or closed or abandoned. If I'm saying yes, it is considered as a discontinuing operation, already been disposed of, closed or abandoned. If I am saying no, if the component is part of a single plan to dispose separate major line or geographical area, when I am saying, again I am coming back, whether the component is already being considered as part of the disposal group, closed group or abandoned group, this is considered as a discontinued operation. Because if you see, only held for sale, we are saying if it is already disposed of, we should not consider it as held for sale. Whereas when we are talking about it's a discontinued operation, we are talking about what is already discontinued during the period also to be taken into consideration. What is planned to be disposed in the subsequent period over a period of time is also to be taken into consideration, right? That is the reason why it comes back and asking the question, has the component already been disposed of, closed or abandoned? That is a discontinued operation during the period. Along with it, what is going to be discontinued, disposal group relating to that particular business, major line of business or geographical segment will also be added. Two element is included in discontinued operation is what we have seen in the previous slide. Suppose if I'm saying no, there could be a possibility that is relating to a subsidiary which has been acquired with an exclusive idea to resell. Again, we will go back, if I'm saying yes, whether it is already been disposed of, closed or abandoned, then it will go to yes. Suppose if I'm saying no, then in that particular situation, we will go to the continuing operations classification. Only one thing which is missing here, I think that can also be taken into consideration, because I'm using the word whether has the component already been disposed of or closed or abandoned. We can change this to have a better understanding. Has the component already been disposed of, closed or abandoned, or going to be disposed based on a disposal group identified as held for sale? So that will be a more better thing, because in the previous slide, if you see the previous slide, we have considered not only disposed during the period, but also held for disposal. Both are considered. And to that extent, if we are changing this particular portion of that as to have one more element, has the component already been disposed of, closed or abandoned, or going to be part of a disposal group as per Ind AS 105. In both the scenarios, it will be considered as discontinued operation. Please make the correction in your working notes when you are looking into on this particular flowchart. Now, suppose if I'm saying, okay, if I'm saying that, okay, it's coming out of second one, preferably we can have it here. Suppose if I'm saying that a component is already been disposed of, etc., I'm saying that whether it meets the criteria for held for sale. So if it is held for sale as a disposal group, if it is a single asset, it will be continuing operation. But it meets the criteria of held for sale as a disposal group, it will be a discontinued operation. That's the reason why you are keeping both coming here. Preferably make a clear note that here itself it is happening as part of disposal as well as planned disposal. Both will be continued as a discontinued operation. Okay. If it is a single asset, it is a continuing operation, not a segment which has been disposed of or major line of activity which is disposed of. And accordingly, it is to be shown as part of the continuing operation, which we have already discussed that. So, arising out of that, if at all I wanted to say a particular area is to be considered as discontinuing operation, what is the additional conditions which we are seeing? Okay, if it is held for sale, classified as held for sale, it is also discontinuing operation. So, don't make any changes, because automatically it comes here through this particular scenario. If it meets the criteria, yes, it goes here. If it is not meeting the criteria, it goes for continuing operation. So you are very clear on this. Maybe I have not completely seen the flowchart as a refreshment before I sat on this. That's the reason why I lost the flow on this. So you can just keep this, no need for making a change. But here you can understand that it also includes the second category, classmate is held for sale and remeasured as remeasured as per Ind AS 105, then go for discontinuing operations, right? Okay, now, so the three conditions. So we said additional condition has to be seen. That additional condition came as part of the flowchart. Let us understand what is the additional conditions comes as a summary. It should represent a separate major line of business or geographical area of operation. It can never be a particular asset or a small CGU. It should be a separate major line of business or geographical area of operation. That is an additional condition. Part of single coordinated plan to dispose of separate major line of business or geographical area of operation. Again, it goes as meeting the criteria of held for sale. That is what the second scenario which is coming in. Third is, it is a subsidiary which has been acquired with an exclusive view to resell. These are all the additional conditions where it will be considered as disposal group. Otherwise, it will not be considered as a disposal group. It will be disclosed as part of your continued operation. So you have to look into that flowchart, and whatever is a summary of the flowchart is nothing but the three conditions is what we are supposed to test to consider that as a discontinuing operation. Let's take some example to understand this. Here, entity B is a retailer of takeaway food. It decides to sell one of its outlets C based in India. Entity B will continue to run the remaining 500 other outlets. All Ind AS 105 criteria for held for sale classification were first met in 23rd May 2020. Outlet C will be sold in September 2020. Management believes that outlet C is a discontinued operation and wants to present the results of outlet C as discontinued operation. Whether it attracts the definition of whatever we are talking about as major segment or major business or geographical segment, or we are talking about whether it is a separate, let me adjust the lighting for a moment. Okay, let's leave it. Okay. So when we are talking about that, we are expected to look into that aspect also. What happens is that it is only one outlet. Their major segment is nothing but the takeaway food is a major business segment. And to that segment, the additional condition is not satisfied. Because the additional condition is not satisfied, either based on major line of business or geographical area or a subsidiary acquired with a view to resell, this is only a sale of an asset which has to be reclassified as held for sale as per 105, but the result should be part of the continuing operation. It cannot be shown as part of discontinued operation. Let us take another example. Here, a lot of dates are involved, right? We have to see highly probable, etc., etc. Packaging unit of ABC Limited is reported as separate operating segment. So it meets the criteria, separate operating segment as per discontinuing operations. That meets the additional condition. Now we proceed further. First November, ABC Limited decided to sell the packaging unit and focus on its core operation. So the condition has been, decision has been taken on 1st October 2019. 1st December, agent has been appointed and the price has been appraised and the fair value is expected to be equivalent to the current fair value and the sale is expected to be complete within 1 year. So highly probable sale. 31st March 2020, it was not sold because it expected to be sold within next 1 year. So in that case, on 25th April, the financial statements are authorized for issue. Should the packaging unit has to be considered as discontinuing operation as of 31st March 2020, whether it is as a disposal group held for sale as per Ind AS 105. First condition which we have seen is that it's a major business segment or geographical segment, right? So major line of business activity, and it is an operating segment, so it meets the criteria because it is an operating segment and it's a disposal group. So it will be disclosed as a discontinued operations. And the reason why we are talking about operation is it is independently generating cash flows, right? That's the reason why. And it is a disposal group. For becoming a disposal group, the first part of Ind AS 105 has to be seen. In first part of Ind AS 105, the sale should be highly probable, and the decision has been made, all the five conditions are met. So it is a disposal group as per Ind AS 105 and meets the criteria of discontinuing operation. Both part of Ind AS 105 should be applied on this. How the presentation of discontinuing operation has to be made? Please recap your understanding of your Schedule 3, which we have discussed as part of Ind AS 1, where we said that Schedule 3 requires you to present, as well as Ind AS 1 requires you to present, the result of the discontinuing operation as a separate line item. And the turnover should not be added to the turnover, the expenses should not be added to the line of the expenses, but it should be shown as a separate line item, net of the taxes. Maybe you can show profit or loss on discontinuing operation or line item, and then tax on that particular item as a second line item, net profit or loss after tax resulting from discontinuing operation as a separate line item. Schedule 3 actually gives that particular presentation format. So that is what Ind AS 1 is also requiring. Same line here, 105 says in the statement of comprehensive income, not in your other comprehensive income. In the statement of comprehensive income, you have to show a single line item post-tax result of discontinued operation plus the measurement impact plus or minus the gain on disposal. Gain on disposal. Okay, that should be shown as part of a separate line item in the P&L account. Okay. Suppose we are talking about a scenario where we are talking about post-tax result, but you wanted to show pre-tax, show that and then show the tax line item. Schedule 3 format allows that to be done. Not only in comprehensive income statement, in statement of cash flows also, you have to show what is the net cash flow used in or net cash flow arising from operating activities, investing activities and financing activities. All the three activities, one single line item arising out of discontinued operations under each categories of operating activities, investing activities and financing activities. So what is impacted? Both statement of profit and loss account here, disclosure comes in. Statement of cash flows also disclosure comes in. Whether balance sheet is impacted? No, it is a presentation of a profit or loss or the result, operating result. So to that extent, nothing will happen in this. But Ind AS 105, first portion will have a write down to be done on the carrying value. That will happen in respect of the carrying value of the disposal group. Interestingly, in 105 first part, where we said previous year the decision to dispose it of is not taken, current year it is reclassified as held for sale or as held disposal group, then comparatives of the previous period should not be presented. That's what we have said. But if we are giving the P&L in the same pattern in the current year as well as in the in the current year alone, it will be fully confusing the user. So accordingly, the P&L says you have to represent the comparatives also in the same pattern as a single line item of your statement of comprehensive income, statement of cash flows arising out of discontinued operations separately, and make the adjustment for those items from the previous profit and loss account and show only what is relating to continued operations separately. That is what your disclosure which is required. Balance sheet 105, non-current asset held for sale, balance sheet is not represented because facts and circumstances arises only in the current reporting period. whereas the comparatives relating to discontinued operation in the P&L account in the cash flow statement should be represented. It's a very important concept which you have to keep it in your mind. What do you mean by reclassification? Maybe what is held for sale decided to be reclassified as held for use. In that case, what you have to do? Whatever is the carrying amount as per Ind AS 105 becomes the carrying amount as per Ind AS the respective standard. Only thing which you have to look into is that you have to measure it as if it is never classified as held for sale, including goodwill. That means what? The date on which you have originally reclassified, what is the carrying amount, what is the accumulated depreciation, what is the accumulated impairment loss, that should be replaced with respect to your carrying amount, even though Ind AS 105 is having a different number. Maybe Ind AS 105 has a carrying amount of 120 because you are not tested for impairment, charging any impairment because your fair value less cost to sell is higher and you are not depreciated, you are not amortized. But if it is a held for use, you might have depreciated, and that is what Ind AS 16 says, or Ind AS 38 says, or Ind AS 40 says. So on that basis, as if it is never applied, you have to account for that, both for the non-current asset as well as the related goodwill. Whatever you have returned back, return off the goodwill, you will bring it back as if nothing has happened. When you are bringing back the goodwill, what has to be done? You have to test it for impairment in every reporting period, because it's a mandatory requirement even if there is no indication of impairment. So those principles should be applied when you are reclassifying previously held for sale into held for use, as if it is never reclassified as held for sale. So the related depreciation right from the date of reclassification has to be done. Right from the reclassification as held for sale should be accumulated and adjusted, and then the difference between the carrying amount as per 105 and as per Ind AS 16 or the related standard should be adjusted in the P&L account, including related goodwill which has been knocked off. Okay. Similarly, if a discontinuing operations is now considered as a continuing operation, we have decided to revive that particular operation because a new demand has come back. In that case, you have to re-present only the comparatives. There is no remeasurement involved. We have only reclassified the P&L into continuing operation and discontinuing operation. Now we got to merge together as a continuing operation. That's what we are supposed to do. So that makes us to understand the second portion of Ind AS 105 relating to discontinued operation. Now let us understand the significant difference between Ind AS 105 and AS 24. Ind AS 105 says non-current asset held for sale should be accounted on this basis. There is a recognition principle, there is a measurement principle, there is an accounting treatment, there is a presentation requirement, there is a disclosure requirement. Very extensive guidance which has been given. But AS 24 is not specifically covering non-current asset held for sale. It is only talking about discontinued operations. In that case, what happens to the non-current asset which has been held for sale? It is actually coming as part of the normal standard, AS 10 or AS 26 as the case may be. There it says if it is decided to be reclassified as held for sale, you have to show as part of your current asset. You should not depreciate, or you should not amortize, but you have to test it for impairment. That comes as a comment in the respective standard, but AS 24 per se is relating to discontinuing operation. AS 105, this is error. What it says is that in Ind AS 105, the cash flow statement should be restated. That's what its requirement. Whereas AS 24, there is no such restatement required for cash flow statement if there is a discontinuing operation. Actually, this does not mention about cash flow is to be part of AS 24. Requirements relating to cash flows are given is should be part of Ind AS 25. The biggest enemy when we prepare anything is your copy paste, and it may happen in any places. I will find it out and correcting during the course of the presentation. If you are finding it, please make a comment for the benefit of all. That's what I am saying, that if there is an error inadvertently which I am not able to consider or I have not spotted, the auditor in you might have spotted that. To that extent, post that also as a comment. I will review that, whether it's an error. In that case, if it's an error, I will admit that error, so that it will be a corrective measure for the users of the YouTube channel. That also you can make it. I never believe that only you have to post the appreciation. If there is a mistake, point out that mistake also. It is my responsibility to accept the mistake if it is a genuine mistake. Deals with the discontinued operations. That means when we are talking about discontinued operation, whereas here there is no discontinued operation. The standard itself uses the word discontinuing operation. But when you are saying discontinuing operation, Ind AS 105 indirectly uses that also. If you see that, what is discontinued during the year and what is going to be part of a disposal group, both are covered as per Ind AS 105. But even though the wording is used as discontinued operation, it also takes into consideration both. But here it is only considering discontinuing operations. Abandonment of an asset should not be classified as held for sale. That we have seen. It should be considered as part of the continuing operations only, and it will be considered as part of discontinuing operation as per AS 24. That's the basic differences. Only mistake which I have spotted is this should be interchanged. Otherwise, everything is all right. This deals with the discontinuing operation. We are using the word discontinuing operations in the standard, but indirectly it also uses the discontinuing operations as part of the disclosure. The wording used is different, but the concept remaining the same. Whereas here, the concept is discontinuing operation. What is discontinued during the year, I need not make any specific disclosure because it has already affected my P&L account. Okay, this is what our discussion. So what we have discussed, we have talked about non-current asset held for sale or a disposal group held for sale as part of Ind AS 105 first portion of the standard, how it will have the recognition principle, measurement principle, accounting treatment to be done, and what should be the presentation requirement, what is the disclosure requirement. First part is seen. Second part, we have discussed about the discontinued operations, but the discontinued operation includes a disposal group which is going to be disposed in the subsequent period. So both discontinued operation as well as discontinuing operations are going to be combined as a second part of Ind AS 105, where it will have an impact of how to present that result of the discontinuing operation in the statement of profit and loss account and statement of cash flows. That's what we have seen. And there are conditions for identifying what is a disposal group or the discontinuing operations. We have seen certain conditions. We have also seen a flowchart. And what is the related disclosure also we have seen. Okay. To make us to have a connected reading, we also dealt with what is the difference between AS 24 and Ind AS 105. With that, I close this session on Ind AS 105, non-current assets held for sale and discontinued operations. And any questions, any comments, any inputs, any additional thing which you want to understand, please post it in our YouTube channel. I will answer that so that you will also have immediate notification. All your friends will also have the immediate, all our subscribers will also be having immediate notification. In case if you are sharing only the link to your friends, because again the statistic says around 40% of our viewers are non-subscribers. So I will encourage them to be subscribers for the channel so that you will not be under the mercy of another subscriber to share the link. when I'm posting new videos, new comments, a new response, new answers, additional facts, you will not be under the mercy of another subscriber. So I encourage you, for your own benefit, be part of our subscribers list in the YouTube channel. Thank you very much for your patient viewing, and goodbye. Stay safe, stay at your home. We will come back with another India Standard as part of our India's Knowledge Series videos. Until then, goodbye.